Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
Hey, what's going on, guys? This is Zeke. This is Dogumentary TV. This is the YouTube channel for dog lovers. If you guys have not already, would you please go ahead and subscribe to the channel? Furthermore, if you would, if you're here right now, please go ahead and hit that like button. I would appreciate that. All right, this is a new show, new format, going live. I've been trying to test on a lot of stuff the last couple of days, and I'm trying to figure this thing out. I want to get a little bit more interactive with you guys and bring the community into the process of the content creation on this channel. Furthermore, having conversations with you guys is real good for me because it gives me ideas of things that I need to shoot and things that I need to go out and film. So I do appreciate you guys' input. If you watch the show on Saturday, I have a new feature where if you guys want to call in, and I encourage you to call in, you can do a video call. In the description of this video, there's a link. You click on that link, and you will get a video camera. A virtual video camera will pop up on your device, whether it be a desktop, a device, an iPhone, or whatever. You can then make a video call into the show. All right, guys, so the title of today's show, Let's Talk Dogs, Best Home Protection Dogs. Now, part of what this format's going to be about is, contentiousness or conversations going back and forth make for a little bit more interesting content. So if you guys do call in with an idea, and I'm going to probably play devil's advocate because it's good for content. It's also good for academics. It's also good for academia. It's good to kind of stretch the boundaries of our understanding of things. I welcome your questioning me or calling me to defend my stance on things. But in terms of home protection, I've obviously made the decision that I'm going to go with the Rottweiler as my home protection animal. Almost 2 years into having a Rottweiler, very happy with my decision. My dog is a great visual deterrent. He's an audible deterrent. Fortunately for me, up to this point, we haven't had any issues where he actually has had to go after anybody. He has stood in between my wife and a guy who wasn't really a threat. He was just a stranger. But he did stand his ground. And he hasn't had any protection training yet. It's pretty much just obedience training, socialization, and bonding with the family. He's a house dog. He lives in the house for the most part. He is crate trained. And when I say he lives in the house for the most part, he's in the house when we're in the house. He is let out in the backyard for, a few hours a day. I also have a kennel that if for some reason I'm away from the house or we're away from the house for a while, he can be in the kennel for up to like 3 or 4 hours a day, but that's only when there's no one home. I have another dog, Bernie, who is a pit bull mix. He's 13 years old. He doesn't really do much but sleep all day and go for his walks. And, he plays with my son a little bit. Him and my son like to cuddle a lot. All right, so I chose a Rottweiler. If you guys out there, if you have another breed that you like or you want to champion as the best dog for home protection, please look into the description of this video. You will see a link that you can click into, and you can then call into the show. Until I get some calls, I'm going to answer some questions in the comments section. Dominique Brownwell asked him, does my Rottweiler have high drive? I mean, high drive is a relative statement, I guess. My Rottweiler is very athletic. He's still very young. He does have a lot of energy for a big dog, relatively speaking. He's nowhere near has a drive of a Malinois or even American Pit Bull Terrier. Yeah, and I'm happy with that because I'm a middle-aged man. I don't need that kind of energy bouncing around my house. And that's part of the reason why I actually chose the Rottweiler. But I want him to be healthy and happy, so I keep him at a very reasonable weight. He's on the leaner side of Rottweilers for two reasons right now. One is because he's still young. He's still growing. So before we put any serious weight on him, we want to make sure that all of his growing is done, his ligaments, his joints, the spaces between his knees and his bones have closed up. I forget what the correct name of that anatomy is. But so basically, I went for him to grow. Right now, he's about 27 inches, 115 pounds at the withers. We will, I hope to maybe, once he's fully grown, for him to be maybe around 122 pounds for the prime, while he's in his prime. And then as he gets older, say 8, 9 years old, I'm going to probably get him back down to around 118. I think that'd be appropriate. All right. Tom, you called in. I don't know what happened to you, bro. Call back in, please. Love to talk to you. Yeah, if anyone out there wants to call you, what's going to happen is you're going to call in. I'm going to put you in the green room. You're going to wait there for a second till I have a moment to introduce you to bring you into the show. Donald, DJ, what's going on with you, brother? I appreciate you. Let's see. Looking through your comments. This is a comment from John. I guess he's a big fan of the Fila. Hands down, will attack everyone outside your family and be a liability. And that's very true. I mean, when you get a home protection dog, especially in a state like the United States where it's very litigious, you got to be careful with the kind of dog that you choose. All right, guys, we have Tom calling in. How's it going, man?
Oh, going good. How are you?
I'm doing great, man. Where you calling me from?
Wilmington, North Carolina.
Nice.
How's the sound?
It sounds good. I hear you perfectly.
Okay, so I just randomly came across your discussion here, and it's an interesting subject to me. Very much so.
Do you have a dog? You have a dog?
Yeah, I got one sitting behind me. That's a blue tick coonhound.
Okay.
He's a hunting dog.
Yep.
I do not hunt, but I've had a lot of breeds through my life. And as far as homeschooling, I've got a downtown house. There's a window right there.
Mm-hmm.
I'm on the second story, and he hangs his head out of that window and lets the whole neighborhood know this is his territory. It's the loudest bark you'll ever hear in your life. All the neighbors know him. Everyone around me is familiar because he just makes himself, his presence be known.
Right.
So it's not something you could have in an apartment. You could not have in a neighborhood where you have neighbors that would not like a loud dog. And I'm in a downtown area, so it's not the best place for me to have one.
Right.
But luckily, the neighbors around me understand, and they all love him. And they kind of like the fact that he keeps things away. There was a shooting a few blocks away from here. It was on CNN. Three kids were shot and killed there. I left my home this weekend and felt safe because I had a neighbor that came to take care of him, fed him, let him in and out. But I don't have any home security system, no cameras. No one, if someone's in this yard, the whole neighborhood knows.
Right.
It's so loud. I don't know that he would fight. I do know these dogs are used to chase bears down. They'll chase, raccoons, of course. But some people use these dogs to chase bear. Right. But I've seen him be afraid of a turtle or a frog, so.
Probably just need some exposure. But one of the things that you bring up is a great point is that there's a lot of different components to home protection, and your dog probably isn't necessarily a protection dog. It may be more considered a guard animal, but that's a very important aspect of home protection, right? Because I was reading somewhere where a guy said when he was talking to prisoners, and they said, most prisoners, most people who do like breaking and entering, they avoid homes with any dog. It could be a small dog, because at the end of the day, a dog, any dog that, especially when that's vocal, will provide early warning to someone's, someone coming into your house. They will also provide, like you said, if someone's down in the yard, his barking will alert a neighbor to look out the window. And then that person then becomes, aware, a second person that becomes aware of the person that shouldn't be there or be around. So that's a good point. I've done a video on a coonhound. I like them as hunting dogs. I like them as companions. Maybe not so much for city living. You know, if I lived out I've been to North Carolina, but I don't know Wilmington. I haven't been to Wilmington to know what the city's like. But I'm sure there's a lot of hiking trails and rural areas where you could take him outside to enjoy himself and be the best coon hound he can be. I appreciate you calling in. I appreciate the fact that you have a dog that, you know, is taking care of your house, your neighbor's house. How many people in your apartment building?
It's a house.
It's a house, okay.
There's a park behind me.
Oh, okay.
I have room to walk him. It's a 4-mile loop around the lake, and it's all
nice
park. So I do have room to walk, but I have a small yard, so it is like an urban area of Wilmington. It's the downtown area. But I have two little kids live with me, my kids and my wife.
Right.
And they make everybody feel safe. I had to leave my daughter alone for like 10 minutes today before my wife got home. I had to get somewhere.
Yeah.
She feels totally safe. I told him, you know, guard her while I'm gone.
And right, right.
He sat on the couch like a gotcha dad. And I feel safe with him. I just know. I don't know that he would attack someone, though. I can't answer that question. That's always – you don't know how a dog would react
if they see
the owner getting hurt.
Right.
I do know that he would be very vocal in bringing attention to the situation, though. That's what I can always count on. I know he'll do. And when I see these dogs hunt, you know, they're so loud to get their owner over to the dog trying to keep at bay, you know.
Right, right.
They never necessarily bite them and attack them when you watch those videos of hunting dogs.
Right.
But it's a neat subject. I'm enjoying your video. Have a good night.
All right, thanks a lot. And check out the, if you do, Dogumentary TV / Blue Tick Coonhound. I have a video on the breed with a young lady or a woman. She's out here in Southern California. You can find some more information about your breed. Yep.
I will check that out. I appreciate it.
All right, man. Appreciate you. And,
yeah, thank you.
All right, take it easy, man. Take it easy. Yeah, so that's a good point, right? Like, every dog does not have to be a dog that bites. You want a dog that is, like, to me personally, you know, I like the visual deterrence. I like the audible deterrence. And then the point of engaging, yeah, that goes to a whole nother level. But I feel like in the modern world today, 95 to 98% of people or criminals, people in general, I guess, will leave you alone. If you have a dog with you, they're just not going to, especially a big dog, a dog of any size, any breed, let me take that back, for example, if you're in the middle of a physical altercation in the street, or an argument, a disagreement, and you have a chihuahua, I doubt that the person's going to take much stock in your chihuahua. But if you have a cattle dog, you know, a dog that's not necessarily known to be aggressive or be a man biter, even though they do fight. They do have their little bit of tenacity in them, but I guess a person wouldn't necessarily see that in that breed. They're still likely just to leave you alone because your dog is there. It's something to be noted, right? So that's that. So yeah, so definitely a coon hound, which I never thought of. They probably make some of the best alarm systems, because like you said, a coon hound is a hound dog, which basically when hounds get to barking or howling, I guess is what you would call it. I mean, that can be heard for some distance, right? So that's up with that. Like I said, I have chosen the Rottweiler. Let me go back through some of your comments. Guys, if you want to, please, you know, let's get some more calls in here. There's a link in the description. Just, you know, just click the link and you'll call in. Tom just did this. It's really easy to do. Yeah, I don't know if coon is the best. I'm still looking through your comments. Let's see. Ramon said that he's a fan of the Malinois. Now, me personally, for when it comes to home protection, I'm no fan of Malinois. I think Malinois are great military for military application, police application, tactical security situations. I don't like Malinois for home protection. I mean, if you're a fan of the Malinois, if you're a person that really wants to focus your time and energy into owning a Malinois, that's something that you want, then I think it'd be great to have the dog in the house. There's a lot of things that you can do with it. Me personally, a man with two kids, a wife, a job, I don't know if I have the time and energy to deal with the Malinois. Definitely don't like the, I definitely don't like all of the just the energy. It's a lot. It's a lot of energy to burn in a day if you have a Malinois. So I'm not a fan of the Malinois. I do love the breed for military and police applications. I think they're very smart. I think they're extremely fast. They probably can handle levels of commands at like 2, 3, 4 different levels. So that makes them great for, you know, military and police application. Sitting around the house, I think that, you know, I personally like a dog that's just going to be chill. This, you know, that, you know, you walk him, you run him, you bike him, and he's good. You know, he's a companion animal. Let's see what she has to say. Let's see what this guy has to say. So Jeffrey says that he loves the Doberman, but they're a little too clingy, which, you know, to me is the clinginess, what do they call these dogs? When I go live, my mind goes a little bit, kind of weird, but you know what we call Velcro dogs. He's a, you know, give me 1 second, James. The fact that Dobermans are Velcro dogs is great. I think it's a wonderful thing, because at the end of the day, the best ability is availability. If your Doberman pincher is always with you, that means when anything happens, your Doberman pincher will be there. You don't have to call him to your side. You don't have to go find him. He doesn't have to come find you. Again, like I said, then the visual deterrence of it, so that when that person comes to come do something to you, he already sees there's a dog next to you. There's a dog in your vicinity. So he knows that he's going to have to deal with the man and the animal. And that will probably be something that will deter him from doing what he wants to, what he was thinking about doing. James, can you get on camera, please? What's up?
Hey, how's it going, man? Good. Hey, I just wanted to ask you, and I won't be on here very long, but what is your opinion on the Bull Mastiff? Do you like those in general? Because they're one of my favorite breeds, and I was just wondering, like, What is your exact opinion on them? Do you think they're a very good home protection dog or a personal protection dog?
Definitely more of, well, I would say on some level both. You know, obviously personal protection depends on what kind of person you're talking about. For example, and this was, I would say, like for example, I went to Jamaica. So let's say more of the less than first world countries. There are people who own businesses and they have to move with their dogs, right? And that's when I say, you know, a dog like the Malinois, a German Shepherd, a Doberman Pinscher would be great, because they're not as big as a Bull Mastiff, but just as intimidating and agile, and can move with a person if a person has to move. Now, in terms of the Bull Mastiff, again, it's a massive breed. It's a Velcro dog. It's going to stay close to you. It's going to have a high visual deterrence. You know, it's a big dog, right? It's 140, 150 pounds. Bad people are going to avoid it. Audible deterrent, serious bark. Like, you don't have to see the dog to know that the bark, when you hear that bark, that's a big dog. So those two great things in terms of home protection. Now, in terms of actually engaging a person, I mean, that's really what the dog was created for. Now, I don't know who today is really breeding for those things, because I don't necessarily know that dogs that you will find in an AKC show ring are going to have a high level of aggression. I think they will have a natural instinct to kind of stand in between a person. you're going to definitely have to put some kind of training into a bull mastiff to get them to be comfortable or eager to attack somebody. And when I say attack, I don't mean just attack, but to defend you using physical force.
And that's more of mastiffs in general?
I would say so, yes. That's what most of the breeds were bred for. All the mastiff breeds from the Neapolitan, the Cane Corso, the Bull Mastiff, English Mastiff, those are all kind of protection dogs, like property protection, farm dogs, you know. So those are, that's kind of what they were created for.
Yeah. All right, sounds good. And last question, I know you said like the Rottweiler, you have a Rottweiler now, but if you were to choose another dog like in the next couple of years, would a Bull Mastiff be on your list?
I did my favorite breeds. I'm trying to remember, was a Bull Mastiff at the time. And I say I was trying to remember because it does change for me. I meet dogs a lot and I go different places, and every now and then, you know, I'll see a different breed or become more familiar with that breed, and it changes for me. I will say this about the Bull Mastiffs. I love Bull Mastiffs. They're very much like Rottweilers. If I were to get a Bull Mastiff, which wouldn't be out of the realm of possibilities for me, it fits my type, right? If you know, you have, people have types. I like large dogs. I like short hair. I like muscular dogs. I like big heads on dogs. So a Bull Mastiff is definitely fits the type of dog I like. My biggest problem with the Bull Mastiff is excessive drooling. I don't think that, I think that the best Bull Mastiffs are basically AKC dogs, which means to me, I question, not saying it is true or not, I'm just saying, like, you know, without doing a whole lot of research, I question the workability of Bull Mastiffs today. I'm sure that there's a guy that has a program working with working Bull Mastiffs. I can't get him to come on and take part in Dogumentary TV. I would love to talk to him. So those are kind of my thoughts on the Bull Mastiffs.
Yeah, maybe sometime in the future you'll have a video about, like, working Bull Mastiffs.
I would love to do that. I mean, every dog breed that I deal with on my channel, ideally I would like to deal with working dogs because I think that's the point of dogs. But obviously today, in the way the world is kind of structured, we have, you know, most of the best dogs are, in terms of genetics, form, and function, they're in the show ring. Yeah. And one thing about the show ring is that you don't, you know, if you're going to show a dog, you don't want a whole lot of animal aggression or even human aggression, right? Because for, you know, a strange person is going to have to come and evaluate the dog. A serious dog will bite that person, right? Like, it's just like, you're not going to put your hand on my private area. You're not going to, you know, you're not going to check my testicles. Like, the dog's just, you know, so the show people have to kind of socialize and breed away from some of the aggression that is very necessary in working animals.
Yeah. Oh, okay. All right. Sounds good. Well, hey, thank you, Zeke, for answering.
All right, man. Thanks for calling in again, bro. I appreciate you.
No problem. You have a good night.
All right. You too. Now, take it easy. Yeah, man. So, yeah, I like Bull Mastiffs. I mean, like I said, I mean, I have a type of dog, you know, Bull Mastiff, Borble, Cane Corso, Rottweilers. That's my type. You know what I'm saying? That's my type. That's my type. I think they all are great dogs. I think they all make a lot of sense for home protection. Like I said, visually and audibly, they're great deterrents. In addition to that, they're easy to live with. Aside from the drool, my Rottweiler doesn't drool much. He doesn't drool much at all. Actually, I'm very happy with that. He's not a super large Rottweiler. He's only about 115 pounds right now. I keep saying that he might be bigger because I haven't weighed him probably in like 3 or 4 months. So I have to check that out. So we got another call coming in. Shane, how's it going, my brother?
Hey, man, pretty good. Thank you for taking my call. I got a question in terms of home protection dogs. So yes, I'm debating. There are three dogs I'm really struggling between: the Presa Canario, the Dogo Argentino, and the what's the one that looks like the Presa?
Cane Corso?
Yeah, Cane Corso. There you go. Yeah, and I'm leaning towards the Dogo because it just looks so majestic. But in your opinion, what do you think may be best?
Well, like,
and I have kids too.
You have kids. I mean, well, first and foremost, if any dog you get, like, if you're gonna get a dog like that, I'm gonna suggest you get it as a puppy, socialize it, and create strict boundaries. How old are your kids? Especially if you have small kids, like, create strict boundaries around your kids.
10 months and 2 years.
Oh yeah. I mean, honestly, bro, I would. So me personally, right? I waited till my daughter. I wanted a Rottweiler since, you know, I wanted a dog. So, you know, 15, 20 years ago. But I waited till my daughter was 5 years old to get a big dog. And the reason why I waited is because, not because I was worried about the dog biting her, but just, you know, bigger dog. I wanted my daughter to be, like, stable on her feet in terms of her ability to walk, run, move, and balance herself. Because big dogs typically, especially if you get them as puppies, you know, like, even, like, say, for example, you say you get a Dogo. At 9 months old, he's going to weigh more. Well, your 10-month-old is probably, you know, less than 20 pounds. So, you know, so let's say, you know, when your Dogo's 7 months, very much still a puppy, gets excited, and your daughter is like a year and a half. Is your 10-month-old daughter?
Yeah.
Yeah, your daughter's like a year and a half. She just starts walking. It won't take much for her to get knocked over by that dog. And the dog, it wouldn't necessarily be the dog's fault because, I mean, at the end of the day, he's still a puppy. He gets excited. But yeah, at this point, he probably outweighs your daughter by about 30 pounds, 40 pounds. And he can run through the house or move through the house and knock her over. So for me, I waited. Right, because I wanted my kids. I already had a dog, first and foremost, but I wanted my daughter, who was my youngest child, to be on her feet before before my puppy get to a size where he can knock her over. Now he's still, my dog weighs more than both my kids. He can still knock them over, but they're a little bit. You know, my son probably weighs about 80 pounds. My daughter weighs about 70, and they're a little bit better on their feet. Now there's ways around it. I mean, you know, you would, if you want to get a big dog, obviously you just have to create the rules and boundaries. You know, maybe there'll be less, the time the dog spends in the house is a bit more structured, because to me, I would just be wary of, or me personally, I was very much wary of having a dog of any size run through the house and knock over a small child. Mm-hmm. With that being said, you've picked three great breeds. What part of the world you live in?
I live in Denver right now, but I'm eventually going back to Florida.
Okay. Florida, I think, you know, all of those dogs have short coats. So they'll be great in Florida. Maybe not so great, and I don't know how cold it gets in Denver. I'm sure you can have a kind of course on Denver. Again, you got to just kind of deal with the frigid cold when it gets real cold. But Florida, you
should be fine. Yeah, it's not as bad as, like, Michigan or nothing.
Right. Mm-hmm. But a Dogo, a Preston, a Cane Corso. I mean, like I said, put them in a hat and pick one, bro. I mean, it's the same. It's really the same dog. What I will say though is that, like, if you have any aspirations to go hunting, you know, you want to shoot and want to catch and kill boar, I would go toward the Dogo. If you wanted to do more, if you were a guy that did a lot of hiking, you spent a lot of time outdoors, I would maybe say go Dogo, right? But any of these dogs can, they'll all do pretty much the same thing.
Is any more just aggressive or harder to control though?
Well, that's going to depend on the bloodline. Obviously, I would say of any of them, to be the one that I would worry most about in terms of aggression and controlling would be the Presser, because Pressers aren't necessarily in this country bred for the show ring. So if you're worried about control, I think the easiest dog to find one that you can control would be a Cane Corso. There's a lot of great Cane Corsos being bred for the AKC show ring. So you'll get a healthy dog with, you know, depending on, you know, the breeder and how you raise it and all that stuff, you'll get a solid dog from an AKC show ring, from an AKC show breeder. Now, the Presser Canario, the Dogos, those dogs are typically going to be bred. Although the Dogo is available in the AKC too, so you can find an AKC breeder who probably breeds great Dogos as well. You'll have less selection than you would if you were going for the Cane Corso. Pressers, it's not an AKC breed. I think it's a UKC breed. But most of the Presser people that I see, a lot of them are breeding working dogs. So that means in the presser, that means there's going to be animal aggression, some human aggression. If they're not going to be, they shouldn't be shy to bite, right? So that's going to be on you to control that. So for the small kids though, and it sounds like you're not really into the hunting or the working aspect, I would just stay away from the presser. I would look into the AKC, looking for an AKC show breeder that's health testing their dogs. And I would go with the, you know, Cane Corso or the Dogo. And I would just basically at that point, you'll have more selection. There are more Cane Corso breeders and Dogo breeders in this country, I believe, especially in the AKC, I'm sure. And you will probably find, a great dog there, you know. Or you, okay. If you really want, you can also maybe go to the shelter, because at this point, I don't know, like there's a lot of people breeding these dogs that probably end up in a shelter. You don't usually find a lot of purebred dogs in shelters, but Cane Corsos you probably could find in a shelter because there's just so many people breeding them. You would just want to make sure you got them at a good age, health tested them, and did your due diligence.
Man, bro, I appreciate it, man. I really love your show, by the way. Thank you, man. Really knowledgeable. And thank you for your time.
All right, Shane, man. Thank you for calling in.
All right,
bro. Take it easy. Yeah, man, that's a tough thing about, trying to pick a dog. There's a lot of great dogs out there, man. I can't pretend like a Cane Corso is inherently better than a Presser, right? Because at the end of the day, it's really going to depend on the breeder. It's going to depend on the breeder's program. That's going to be, 50% of it. Then, another 45% of it is going to be the owner's ability to control the dog, to socialize the dog, train the dog, and all that other stuff. It's going to determine whether or not you're going to have a great dog or not. A lot of great dogs are destroyed by bad owners, and a lot of great genetics are destroyed by bad breeders. So, but you pick basically three dogs that, are pretty much in the same kind of grouping, how I would group them. Good night. He asks, what's the best protection dog for first-time owner families? That's a great question. Let me think about that, because there's a lot of great dogs out there. I mean, at the end of the day, any dog, like I said, any dog of size would be somewhat of a home protector. A lot of people think, when you think home protection, you think like, oh, I want a dog that's going to go out and attack somebody. I did a video, I kind of talked about that on Saturday with Do We Need Dogs That Bite? And, the reality of it is that 99.9% of the home protection that you're going to get from a dog, will never bite. But, like your dog is protecting your home every single day. Your dog is protecting you. You're walking the streets. People see you who might want to take something from you. You got a dog. They say, not going to mess with him. He's got that big dog with him. So that's protection right there. That's personal protection. Someone comes to your house, they're casing your house. They want to figure out like any little weak spots in your home. They can maybe sneak in and get something, but they hear a dog behind the door barking, a big dog. They decide, that's not the house I'm going to rob. I'm going to find someplace a little bit softer to hit. So, any dog, I believe, will provide a certain level. Any dog of any size, any substance, will provide a certain level of home protection. When you get into the dogs that you want, that are going to bite or engage a man, it's hard to say those dogs are cool for first-time dog owners. It's just not something that I think would be responsible for me to say. But with all that being said, like, it is possible if you put in the work, the effort, the time. One of the things I believe is that if you want to get a dog as a first-time dog owner, you can get any dog, but you got to take it serious as if it's a job, as if it's a responsibility, right? Like, for example, if someone said, look, I'm going to give you this truck. It's a $100,000 truck. It's a tractor-trailer truck, right? You're not going to assume that, like, oh, I'm going to go just drive this truck home. Like, no, you're going to find somebody who knows how to drive a tractor-trailer. You're going to have them drive it back to your place, because that's a smart thing to do. If you don't know how to drive a tractor trailer, And you're going to work with that person. And you're going to learn how to drive a tractor trailer. Same thing should be done with a dog that is possible. That is probably beyond your realm of understanding and ownership, right? So if you want to get a dog that's aggressive, partner with your breeder, partner with a mentor, someone who can help you set up the rules, the boundaries, the limitations, the routines for owning a dog. I would get a puppy so that you before the dog becomes a serious threat, you have time to learn how to control the dog. And also your bonding and the dog is very much key to what it is you want it to do and how you want it to be done. So those are typically best practices if you are a first-time owner and you want to get an aggressive dog. Now, me personally, I typically would just recommend get a less than, start with a lab, start with a, and don't think like labs are easy dogs to own. They're not. It's like there's a lot to be learned in owning a lab. But yeah, so I don't know. First time dog owner, I say any dog, if you have a family, especially if you have small children, just start with a lab. He's not going to bite anybody. He shouldn't, he may, but I wouldn't be banking on that. I would more so bank on the fact that he would be alert. Or you know what, you can even get a Chihuahua, bro. Chihuahuas, again, I'm not saying they're great home protectors, but they are amazingly loud. And they will let you know if someone's coming to your house. And they will tell someone that, my element of surprise has been taken away by this pesky little animal. All right, guys, look in the description. You can, if you want, call in. We've had two calls so far. I got about probably 10 more minutes for this show. I would love to have some more people call in and get to your questions or whatever. Like I said, I chose a Rottweiler. We've had some people talking about a Bull Mastiff, Connie Corso, Presa Canario, Dogos, all great dogs. Looking through your comments right now. John Batt says that a pit bull terrier makes some of the best personal protection dogs if trained well. I don't necessarily know that I agree with that. I've never seen what I would consider to be a game American pit bull terrier trained for personal protection. I've seen American pit bull terriers. I've seen very athletic American pit bull terriers. I've seen very classic looking or appropriate American Pit Bull Terriers that fit the American ABBA standards of American Pit Bull Terriers. But to me, a game dog is something very special and very specific, and I don't know that we see a lot of game dogs today. So I don't know. They are very much athletic. They're going to have a serious bite. But they really should be what do you call it? It should not be human aggressive at all. All right, we got another call from another Tom. How's it going, man?
Pretty good. How about yourself?
I'm good, my brother. Where you calling from?
Massachusetts.
Nice. All right. So what's your thoughts?
As far as like home protection, personally, I love Rottweilers. I love King Corsos. I love Bull Mastiffs. But I also like the speed and dexterity of like German Shepherds, Belgian Malinois, those types of breeds. And personally, I'm a person that lives like more of an active lifestyle. I'm a runner. So I was wondering like what your thoughts are on having a dog that's like powerful enough and bulky enough as like a King Corso or a Rottweiler, but one that can also be like good for a person with an active lifestyle, like a German Shepherd or a Malinois. Right.
How much running do you do? Like how far do you run and how fast do you run?
So my average speed is maybe about like 5, maybe 6 miles per hour. And I'll do about, 20 to 40 miles per week. Each of my runs are maybe about 5 to 7 miles, give
okay.
or take.
Okay, okay. So you're a runner. All right, that's cool. So I mean, for me, I would say, you know, German Shepherd sounds great. You know, I think a German Shepherd is a good compromise between a Malinois. It has, you know, it doesn't necessarily, it has the intelligence of the Malinois. It's a little bit bigger, has a little bit more stopping power. It doesn't have the stopping power of a Rottweiler, but it has more than a Malinois. The problem I have with Malinois in terms of home protection is, first and foremost, like I said, you know, like, you know, home protection means you're going to be in a spot and the threat's going to come to you.
Yeah. Right?
I think a bigger dog is there for stopping power. When you're talking about a Malinois, I think it's better for police work where someone's running away from you and he goes and gets it. You feel me? So I think, you know, so I think, but you seem to have enough of activity and energy, you're spending enough time and energy running that you could definitely own a Malinois. I think, you're running about 40 miles a week. So that's about 4 miles, 7 goes into 40, a little over 5. So maybe like 5.5 miles a day is what you're running.
Yeah, give or take around that. Maybe a little bit more sometimes, but not too often.
Yeah.
So it's around,
Right. So, but you know, and the thing about it is that may be just enough for a Malinois, though. You know, a Malinois might, he might can run 10, 15 miles a day, to be honest with you.
Oh, yeah,
so you,
definitely.
So you will definitely run them for the time that you run them. That would be great. Then you're probably going to need to spend another 20 minutes, 30 minutes a day training him. Because he's a very smart dog, right? A Malinois is a very intelligent dog. So he's going to need tricks and games to play that expresses his intelligence. And then you should be fine at that point. But, you know, it's a lot more activity than, say, for example, if you got a canine Corso and you ran him 5 miles a day. You know, if you're running 5 miles a day, I would probably try to get a female, because you want a lighter dog. Yeah. You probably want one that's going to be around 100 pounds, 110 pounds. You don't want 140 pound canine Corso. Yeah. Another thing with canine Corsos and Rottweilers is you wouldn't really be able to run them till they're like 2-3 years old, because you got to wait till they stop growing before you start putting that kind of distance on them and at that speed. Yeah. So
Oh yeah, sorry. My concern with like dogs and stuff is their joint health. That's definitely like a big thing for me. I want to make sure that they have like long lasting joints and muscles and stuff like that, and they can go into their older years.
Right.
Also, I know that you have a little bit of experience with Doberman Pinschers. I watch a lot of your content. I love it, by the way.
Thank you.
What are your experiences on, or what are your thoughts on Doberman Pinschers as protection and running dogs as well? I know they were bred to be protection dogs.
Yeah, for sure. I think I'm glad you brought up the Doberman Pinscher, because I was about to say Dogo, but I think Doberman Pinscher is probably the perfect dog for you, actually. Because you can probably start running them at 2 years. They should be, I don't know, talk to your breeder. If you get a dog, talk to the breeder about when he recommends, you know, letting them go full tilt. But it's a large dog, so you're not going to want to run it hard as a puppy, but you want to wait. But once you do, a Doberman will run, you know, he'll run 6-7 miles a day and really be real happy to do that and not necessarily need all the extra work that a Malinois might, you know. So German Shepherd and Doberman Pinschers, I think those are probably your best options if I was making a choice and I lived your life.
All right,
awesome. Tom.
Well, thank you very much. I'll let you go.
All right, thanks, brother. All right, man, I appreciate you. Have a great day. Great evening.
Yeah, you too.
All right, peace, man. Uh-huh. Yeah, man, that's a good one. You know, he's living a good life, right? He's out there running, young man. Once you get a dog for protection, I think, you know, Doberman Pinscher is definitely something that he should look into. I was also thinking of Dogo. I don't know what he does. Dogo, Doberman Pinscher, you know, I think Doberman Pinscher is probably the dog, the breed to go with in that situation. All right, guys, we'll take one more call, and then we're going to wrap it up. But I do want to thank everybody for calling in, checking us out. I want to thank you guys for watching. Let's see, I got Muhammad here. Muhammad, you on camera? There you go. What's going on, Muhammad?
Hi.
How you doing, man? You got a question? Want to make a comment?
I've been watching your channel for a couple months, and it's like really cool. And I was just like wondering, how are like Dalmatian, because like they work with the fire department, and I just wanted to know how they are as like a, like just family, because I have younger siblings, like a 3-year-old, 8-year-old. So yeah, I was wondering how they are as a dog in general.
I like Dalmatians as I don't do a lot of research and reading on Dalmatians. Something in my head is telling me that they do have an issue with biting kids. And I don't know if that's true or not. That's kind of what's just popping in my head. I would have to do a little bit of research, and I suggest that you do research. They're great dogs. They're active dogs. They're really good for people who are like out and about. If you're out and about.
Yeah, we are.
Spend a lot of time in the park. You're definitely going to have to put some obedience and socialization on a dog, especially when you have a family. And Dalmatians are the type of dogs that, you know, people, even strangers, feel comfortable approaching, right? Because of the 101 Dalmatians. Everyone's familiar with the breed. Everyone thinks the breed is a cartoon character. They're great dogs. I don't have a whole lot of experience with them because they're not like typically my type of dog. I do have a video. If you look on my channel, I did a video with a woman. Just search Dalmatian and then Dogumentary TV. That video will pop up, and you can check out what she has to say. She's a woman, I believe. She's been breeding the dogs for like 30, 40 years, so she's very knowledgeable on the breed. And she'll probably be the best source that I have for that kind of information.
Okay, thank you. And I have one more question.
Sure thing.
It's just like about like ethical breeding. And so I was like looking at Doberman Pinschers too, and I just saw the white color and how it's like kind of shamed on by some people, and it's not, seems like it's not natural or whatever.
Right.
So I just wanted to know like your thoughts, because like I really like the color, but I just don't know if that like brings more health problems, and it's just whether it's just white or not.
Yeah. I don't believe that. I do know that there's a lot of controversy around it. I've dealt with a woman who, and I have a video on my channel. She's a proponent of the white Doberman. There was a lot of controversy around that in her statement. From my experience, you know, white dogs, all white dogs can have health issues, can have hearing issues. I would not necessarily, me personally, I wouldn't go for the white Doberman. I just feel like, well, first of all, it's not a color that I'm attracted to. I think the black and tan, the black and mahogany is just, that's just the Doberman as I know it. The rust is cool too, but yes, I don't know. I mean, I think that, like I said, there's a lot of controversy around that. I don't know the science of it. I just kind of know the general opinion that it's probably something you want to stay away from.
All right. So, yeah, thank you.
All right, thank you, Muhammad. I appreciate you, bro. Take it easy, man.
Good night.
All right, guys, I'm going to go ahead and wrap up the show. I want to thank all you guys for checking me out. This is Let's Talk. Let's Talk Dogs. If you guys, if you watch this video and you watch it later, you can also leave a comment something you want to talk about moving forward. If you guys have any ideas of conversations that we can have around dogs, leave the comment. That's something we can talk about. I'm going to probably do this like 2 or 3 times a week right now. On the horizon, I have several videos that's going to be dropping soon. I have a hunting with Brittany's that I'm actually editing right now. And then I'm also editing Living with Chow Chow. So those videos will be dropping. Hopefully, both videos will be dropping but this week. So be on the lookout for that. Also, I'm going to start going live a little bit more often. As you can see, I've put up a light. I got my big camera. I got some backlight. It looks a little bit nicer in here. I think I'm ready to do this a little bit more often. So we're going to do this, you know, 2-3 times a week. Let's Talk Dogs. Additionally, I will be bringing on some people. I'll be doing video interviews on this channel. One of the things I learned from COVID is that, you know, I can't get everywhere. And I just kind of got to accept the fact that, you know, I won't necessarily go see everybody. I'll just have to, like, just have the conversation and bring forth the information for you guys to have that. Other than that, this is Zeke. This is Dogumentary TV. If you haven't already, please go ahead and subscribe to the channel. I'll talk to you guys on the next one. Peace.